Most respected faculty of today's virtual CP seminar, CAT Banushekar sir from Chennai, the vice chairman of Kannur branch, CA Pijaraji, treasurer Dinesh sir, member and immediate past chairman Saju Sridhar, illustrious past chairman of Kannur branch, members of the profession, and my dear participants, very good afternoon to all of you. Today we are extremely delighted with the presence of the leading direct tax professional in India, who argued in a number of landmark cases before various benches of income tax appellate tribunal across the country, author of direct tax books, excellent teacher, the senior chartered accountant CAT Banushekar sir from Chennai. Sir, on behalf of Kannur branch and all present here, I'm taking this opportunity to welcome you to the CP seminar of Kannur branch, and at the same time thanking you for accepting our invitation as a faculty of this virtual seminar hosted by Kannur branch. Sir, welcome you, sir. Welcome. I'm taking this opportunity to welcome all the members and participants to this seminar. As usual, on next Wednesday, that is on 5th August, we will have a session on firm versus LLP versus companies by CA Rangaraj at 6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Requesting all the Kannur branch members to fill the Google form, which is mandatory requirement to have CP credit for the Kannur branch members. Now I requesting the vice chairman PJ Raji to formally introduce the faculty of this session. Thank you, Raji.
Respected chairman CA Jayaprakash, renowned speaker for today's webinar CAT Banushekar sir, my managing committee members, illustrious past chairman of Kannur branch, my fellow members in the profession, students and dear friends, a very good afternoon to all of you. It's my pleasure and great privilege to present before you a great personality and an eminent speaker, CAT Banushekar sir. CAT Banushekar sir, in practice as a partner in Mrs. C. Ramaswamy and B. Srinivasan Chartered Accountants, Chennai since 1994. He contributed articles on direct taxes and international taxation to several tax journals, including Consolidated Commercial Digest, Taxman, Tax Referencer, and the Income Tax Review. He have argued in a number of landmark cases before various benches of ITIT across the country, which have resulted in establishing precedents for many common contemporary issues. Important among such cases are Ford India Limited relating to claim of deduction for warranty expenses, Saksoft Limited before the special bench on parity between numerator and denominator in computing deduction under Section 10A, Ford Business Services Center Private Limited relating to the benefit under Section 10A, SSI Limited relating to taxability of ESOP, Vijaya Productions relating to the accrual of capital gains, Apollo Hospitals Enterprises Limited relating to taxability of capital gains earned in India on sale of shares of Sri Lankan company, Eastman Export Global Clothing Private Limited relating to taxability of export incentive, Filtrex Technologies Limited relating to disallowance of expenditure under Section 40A1, Playtex Limited relating to application of provision of Section 163, South India Corporation Limited relating to disallowance of interest paid on borrowed funds on accrual on account of interest-free advances to group concerns, AVM Charities relating to claim of exemption under Section 11, Hillcroft Pharma India Limited relating to allowability of sales promotion expenditure in the form of rebates and gifts, Synergy Maritime Limited relating to transfer pricing issues. He have argued in a number of cases in various benches of Income Tax Settlement Commission also. He authored two books, one Handbook on Assessment
okay,
of
HP.
Income Tax Act 1961, and the second HP. One, Search Assessment under the Income Tax Act. He formerly a visiting faculty of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Institute of Company Secretaries of India, and Loyola Institute of Business Administration. He delivered lectures and presented a number of papers on direct taxes and international taxation at seminars, meetings, workshops and conferences arranged by various branches and regional councils of ICAI. He participated in training programs for commissioners of income tax conducted by the Regional Training Institute of Income Tax Department. Has been the chairman of the Direct Tax Committee of the Hindustan Chamber of Commerce, formerly a columnist in the Hindu Business Line, in the personal finance page featured on Sundays, authoring the column Tax Talk. Former member of the SCRC of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India for the period 2001-2004. Past chairman of Fiscal Law Committee of the SCRC of ICAI. Was a special invitee in the Direct Tax Committee of ICAI and in the CPE Committee of the ICAI. Presently, a co-opted member of the Direct Tax and International Tax Committee of SCRC of ICAI. Dear members, this is a very brief introduction of CIT Banishagar sir. Sir, we are extremely happy and delighted to have you here in this afternoon as the speaker for today's virtual seminar. Thank you, sir. Over to the chairman.
Thank you, Raji. Thank you, Raji. So over to Banishagar sir.
So the office bearers and the other members who are present here, first of all, a very warm good afternoon. I think we've all been going through trying times in terms of the COVID-19. But at the same time, I think this has been a great boost for people who are interested in seminars and webinars. In fact, there are so many seminars and webinars today that sometimes it is becoming difficult to even keep track of the number of seminars and webinars that are happening, and probably even to the extent to which we are committing to seminars and webinars. Well, it's indeed nice that we can share knowledge and exchange our expertise on various subjects during this period. Well, I must first of all thank Mr. Reji for those kind words which were read out. But participants, let me first of all warn you that all those kind words were written by me and given. Therefore, they were probably only kind, and they are bound to be only kind. And secondly, I must be grateful to your chairman for inviting me for this webinar. In fact, he sent out a very polite mail asking me whether I will be able to make myself available. And I must really say that I was really glad that I could address a set of members with whom I have always felt very close with. I immediately agreed. And of course, your chairman will vouch for the fact that I immediately sent back a message saying we will confirm the date a little later. But so far as speaking, why not? We will definitely do it. Well, friends, the topic of reassessment and revision is probably a topic which is evergreen. In fact, we have spoken so many times on this topic. But every time we talk or discuss on this subject, I think something new comes out from the subject itself, because the complexity is so much. In fact, you'll all recall that in the recent past, there has been very little action that has been taken by the department, and particularly with the finance minister giving a virtual guarantee that up to July 31st, we will not do anything adverse to the assessment. But at the same time, I'm sure all of you will agree that the period which we are going through is not just a tough period for us alone. It is a tough period for the government also, where government collections in terms of taxes, both direct and indirect tax, have been taking a big beating. And given that they have been taking a big beating, and that, you know, on the one side, revenues are going down, the other side, governmental expenditure, particularly to battle the COVID-related issues, is going up. And the government is also bound to give so many freebies in many ways. And therefore, again, it involves a huge cost to the government. So I am anticipating that once these corona-related issues are over or are substantially subsiding, I am anticipating that the government will go hammer and tongs with collection of taxes. I'm anticipating that they will go hammer and tongs to try and see the maximum amount of taxes that they can collect. Well, one cannot blame them for it as well, because money is needed to run the government also. So this is going to be something that we are going to be having to face in a little while or a few months from now. We are hoping that everything will subside or at least settle down in a few months too. If that were to happen, I think things will get a lot better in terms of the COVID related issues. But from a necessities perspective, there could be real large scale pressure. There could be large scale pressure on SSEs to pay up the taxes and for the governmental authorities to find newer and newer modes of trying to garner more and more collection, which is but necessary given the kind of expenditure the government has had to incur during these pandemic times. Well, friends, talking about reassessment to start. Now, reassessment basically involves a basic number of steps where if you look at the provisions relating to reassessment starting from 147 to 151, what it requires basically is that the assessing officer must have reason to believe that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. He must have reason to believe that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment, and wherever required, he must obtain the necessary approval before proceeding to initiate the reassessment proceedings. The law also requires that the reason to believe must be recorded in writing, that he must issue a notice under section 148 before proceeding to complete the reassessment. Now, as far as this is concerned, you also have the decision of the Supreme Court in a case called GK and drive shafts, where the Supreme Court held that if a notice under 148 is received, the right course of action on the part of an SSE is to file a return in response to the notice. The right course of action is to file a return in response to the notice, thereafter to seek or to require the assessing officer to give the reasons recorded in writing before initiating the reassessment proceedings, and on receipt of such requisition from the SSE, the Supreme Court held that it shall be the obligation of the assessing officer to furnish the reasons to the SSE, and thereafter the SSE has a right to raise objections, and if objections are raised, the assessing officer must dispose of the objections by a speaking order before proceeding to complete the reassessment. So to repeat the steps very quickly, reason to believe must exist. There must be such reasons which are recorded in writing. Wherever required, proper sanction must be obtained. Notice under 148 must be issued and served. Assessee must file a return of income and thereafter ask for reasons. The assessing officer, on receipt of request for reasons, shall file the reasons or shall furnish the reasons to the assessee. The assessee thereafter has a right to file his objections, and on the assessee filing such objections, the assessing officer shall dispose of the objections by a speaking order before proceeding to complete the reassessment. So these are basic steps. Now, looks very simple and straightforward. Now, there are also a couple of other aspects which we will be dealing with as we proceed, which we will refer to as a change of opinion and a failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure. Not that we will not be discussing about anything else. These are again two other very important aspects which arise from what I call a judge-made law. Where the courts have time and again held that reopening to be justified should not be based on a change of opinion, and in certain cases should not be based on situations where there has already been made a full and true disclosure on the part of the SSE. Now, I will not stick to any particular format, but I will go on a very random basis, because I understand that every single participant of this conference or of this webinar He's himself somebody who has been practicing and is an expert by himself. Recognizing that, I will probably, you know, take ourselves through this session on a random basis so that we all gain the maximum from today's deliberation. I will not deal with certain basics which I presume every one of us would be aware of. Why should I presume? I'm sure everyone is aware of. In fact, I can see in the list of participants people who are such great experts on the subject themselves. And I would be making fun of myself rather than of them if I were to start from basics. I will probably start from what we understand as a change of opinion. I will start with what we understand as a change of opinion, because that forms the basis. Even if reasons are to be recorded, it should not be based on a change of opinion. What do we understand by a change of opinion? Where an opinion has already been formed, and if on that very same basis an assessment is to be framed, that is called a change of opinion. I have circulated the paper with the organizers. All the case laws that I am referring to are already forming part of that paper. So one need not break their head to note down the case laws or the citations that I am referring to. In fact, the paper that I have circulated is a very elaborate paper discussing almost each and every aspect relating to reassessment and revision. Now friends, we were talking about a change of opinion. Now when do we say it is a change of opinion? I said where an opinion has already been formed. And the Supreme Court has held that where the original assessment was framed under 143.1, one cannot say that there is an opinion that has been formed. In fact, there were various decisions giving contrary views. The Madras High Court in Bapalal and Company taking a view in favor of SSE, various High Courts taking a view against the SSE, and ultimately the Supreme Court holding that change of opinion cannot be basis for reopening, of course, but where the original assessment was not framed under 143.3 or 147 and was framed under 143.1, it cannot be said that there is a change of opinion. Now, in so far as a change of opinion is concerned, there is always this question which comes to everybody's mind. In fact, the department has been time and again arguing that the issue of change of opinion should apply only where the assessment is being reopened beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. Where the assessment is being reopened beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. This has been the argument that the department has been taking time and again. But friends, let us remember that the courts have been holding a different view. The issue of change of opinion has got nothing to do with whether the assessment is being reopened within 4 years or beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment. In fact, one can look at the decision of the full bench of the Delhi High Court in a case called Kelvinator of India. The full bench of the Delhi High Court in a case called Kelvinator of India, and if one were to see paragraph 2 of the decision, one can see that the reassessment was done only within 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year, and the full bench of the Delhi High Court held that the reopening was invalid because it was based on a change of opinion. This decision of the Delhi High Court in Kelvinator of India, friends, has been affirmed by the Supreme Court in Kelvinator of India. And therefore, one can now comfortably state, based on the decision of Supreme Court in Kelvinator of India, that the issue of change of opinion is applicable whether the reopening is done within 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year or beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. I will come back to change of opinion in various other aspects. But before that, you will also see that the law requires that there must be reason to believe that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Now, what does one mean by reason to believe? Now, the courts have time and again held that reason to believe is something more than suspicion. Reason to believe is something more than suspicion. In fact, I can share an example of a case that I myself had an occasion to argue in relation to recent review. Now, what happened was a lady's assessment was being framed, and it was found that she had received a gift of, say, 25 lakhs from a person known to her. And the assessing officer came to the conclusion that the reopening was bad in law. Sorry, that the gift was bad or was a fraudulent transaction, and that therefore the addition was to be made. Now, the assessing officer also noticed that the husband had also got a gift of 50 lakhs, but from some other person. Assessing officer said, since the wife has cheated for 25 lakhs, the husband will also be likely to be a person who could have evaded tax by showing a gift of 50 lakhs. Now, we said, this cannot be reason to believe. This can at best be reason to suspect. This cannot be reason to believe. And this found favor with the appellate court. So reason to believe is something much stronger than reason to suspect. And mere reason to believe or suspect is not enough for a reopening to be done. In fact, courts have said or held that there must be a live link. There must be a live link between the reasons and the escapement of income for a reopening to be permissible in law. For a reopening to be permissible in law, there must be a live link between the reasons that are recorded in writing and the escapement of income. But at the same time, courts have said that we will not enter into whether there is sufficiency of reasons. The sufficiency of reasons we will not enter. We will see whether there are reasons to believe. It cannot be based on reason to suspect, of course. Reason to believe will be a subjective term which may depend on facts and circumstances of each case. So the assessing officer must have reason to believe of what? That income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Now, what is income chargeable to tax escaping assessment? If one were to go to explanation 2 to section 147, explanation 2 to section 147, one would find that the courts from time to time have talked about various aspects relating to reassessment. And when we are talking about reason to believe, etc., it says that the reason to believe must be recorded in writing. It must be recorded in writing by the authorities concerned. And the law, you will see, divides it into different categories. I'll put it this way. Be up to 4 years from end of the relevant assessment year, beyond 4 years and up to 6 years from the end of the relevant assessment year, and even beyond that, and up to 16 years from the end of the relevant assessment. Up to 16 years from the end of the relevant assessment. Of course, you will also find that in search assessments, there are certain circumstances where the 153A notice can be issued up to 10 years from the end of the year of search. That is 9 years from the end of the relevant assessment. So there can be different kinds of possibilities. Now, we have been talking about reason to believe. We have been talking about recording it in writing. Now, once I am an assessing officer and I find that there is an escapement of income, when can I say there is an escapement of income? As I was referring to explanation 2 to section 147 of the Act. Explanation 2 to section 147 of the Act says that in certain circumstances, income is deemed to have escaped assessment. And gives out the list. It talks about a case where the SC has not filed a return of income, the loss has been assessed at too low rate, income has been assessed at too low rate, etc. Now, one may basically raise a question. Does this mean that if it does not, a particular aspect does not fall under explanation 2 to section 147, there is no escapement of income? The answer is a definite no. It is a definite no. your general understanding of escapement of income is always applicable. Now, explanation 2 deems certain aspects where there is an escapement of income. For example, no income has escaped. I'm giving just an example. No income at all has escaped, but the SSE has been assessed at too low a rate. The SSE has been assessed at too low a rate. Section 147, the explanation provides that this is also an escapement of income. So one can see that though in normal understanding, this is not an escapement of income, by virtue of the explanation to section 147, this is deemed to be an escapement of income. So 147 explanation 2 is only expanding the scope of escapement and does not exhaustively define what is escapement of income. So once the assessing officer is satisfied that there is an escapement of income, he records his reasons in writing. And thereafter, wherever required, must obtain a proper sanction. The law in section 151 specifically provides of who can issue a sanction in what circumstances. So he is required to obtain that sanction and thereafter think of issuing a notice under 148. This is the procedure for the assessing officer to be followed before issuance of notice under 148. But he must also remember that there is no possibility to reopen on the basis of a change of opinion. So wherever there is a change of opinion, a reopening is barred. And I explained this fairly in detail with the help of the decision of the full bench of the Delhi High Court and also the decision of the Supreme Court in Kelvin et al. Now, number of questions can arise even at this stage. When can we say that an opinion has been formed? I already said that the Supreme Court has held that if the original assessment was framed under 143.1, then one cannot say that an opinion has been formed and therefore one cannot argue about a change of opinion. But at the same time, if an original assessment has been framed, not under 143.1, but under 143.3, say, and questions have been raised, answers have been given by the SSE with all supporting material, say, then is it open to the SSE to state that in such circumstances there is only a case for a change of opinion and there is no case to say that there is no change of opinion? Please note that the assessment order does not state about why the addition is not made. However, the assessing officer in the course of proceedings under 143.3 originally has issued a questionnaire, say, asked for all questions that are possible from the SSE. The SSE has duly responded and given all necessary particulars. Can one urge that the matter has been looked into and an opinion has been formed? In fact, there are a number of decisions on this as well. Where the courts have time and again held that if questions have been raised and replies have been given, then it is presumed that the assessing officer has applied his mind. In fact, if one were to go back to the full bench of the Delhi High Court in Kelvin et al. Of India, the full bench of the Delhi High Court in Kelvin et al. of India said, there is a presumption under the Evidence Act, under 114E of the Evidence Act, that all government authorities have performed their functions in due discharge of their duties and properly. When the matter travelled to the Supreme Court, this issue was not considered by the Supreme Court because that was not the question before the Supreme Court. But then a larger full bench of the Delhi High Court in Usha International has considered this aspect of the decision of the Delhi High Court in Calvinator of India and ultimately come to the conclusion that there is no direct presumption that the authorities have exercised their due diligence in completing the assessment and they are presumed to have conducted it properly. But if the SSA can demonstrate that there were the issues were raised and discussed in the course of assessment, not necessarily in the order, they were raised and discussed in the course of assessment, not necessarily in the order, then the Delhi High Court, a larger full bench of the Delhi High Court in Usha International held that the presumption under 114E of the Indian Evidence Act will apply, and consequently the SSE is presumed to have given all information, the assessing officer is presumed to have formed an opinion, unless the officer can demonstrate that there was no application of mind. That is going to be very difficult, because the officer cannot say, I had all the information but I didn't see it. So that's going to be extremely difficult. So long as issues were raised and discussed in the course of assessment, one will have to conclude that an opinion has been formed, and anything that is done after that may amount to a changeover. I repeat, the issue that was discussed need not, I repeat, the issue that was discussed need not form part of the order that was passed under 143.3. The fact that an order does not discuss it does not matter. Issues have been raised, issues have been discussed, though not finding part in the final order. That is enough to say that there is a change of opinion. Now, when we were discussing a little earlier, we were discussing about various time frames. 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, beyond 4 years and up to 6 years from end of relevant assessment year, and up to 16 years from end of relevant assessment. And up to 16 years from there. I am going to be discussing more and more important concepts as we proceed. But as I will give a brief overview, please remember that up to 16 years from the end of the relevant assessment year, that is beyond 6 years from the end of the relevant assessment year, and up to 16 years from the end of the relevant assessment year is permissible only when there is an undisclosed foreign asset. Only when there is an undisclosed foreign asset, otherwise beyond 6 years is not permissible, excepting as permitted in case of search and seizure cases. Right? So 16 years is only when there is a foreign asset which is reflecting an escapement of income. Right? Now, beyond 4 years and up to 6 years from end of relevant assessment year, when can this be done? So, one will have to understand that the normal time limit is 4 years from end of relevant assessment year. Beyond 4 years and up to 6 years from end of relevant assessment year, when is this possible? This is possible where the original assessment was framed under section 143.3 and where there is a failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure. And where there is a failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure. Right? Now, what is a failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure? In fact, there are two very crucial decisions of the Supreme Court and the Delhi High Court which have to be understood, which have to be very carefully understood for us to appreciate when it can be said that there is a failure on the part of the SSE to make a full disclosure. I'll first deal with the decision of the Delhi High Court. The decision of the Delhi High Court in a case called Honda CL. In fact, this decision of the Delhi High Court, a special leave petition was preferred before the Supreme Court, which has also been dismissed by the Supreme Court. So one will understand that this is a very more than just a Delhi High Court. Now the facts of this case are very, very crucial. The facts of this case are very crucial. And friends, you will pardon me because I am going to refer to a few dates which I normally will refrain from, but this is very, very important for the sake of our understanding. Now, what is the case there? Now, the issue there was with reference to a disallowance to be made under 14A. A disallowance to be made under 14A. Expenditure in relation to exempt income. Now, friends, you may remember that Section 14A was first sought to be inserted by the Finance Bill 2001. The bill being introduced in the Parliament on 28th of February 2001, Finance Bill 2001 was presented in the Parliament. It proposed that Section 14A will be inserted with retrospective effect. Now, in the instant case, Honda CL, the impugned assessment year was assessment year 2000-2001. The impugned assessment year was assessment year 2000-2001. And a return was filed by the SSE. Note carefully, a return was filed by the SSE in November 2000. 2000-2001, return filed in November 2000. When was the bill presented? The bill was presented 3 months later in February 2001. However, when the assessment was taking place, the assessing officer did not raise any query on the disallowance under 14A, nor did the SSE respond to the query. Nor did the SSE respond since there was no query on 14. No query was raised. SSE also did not refer to 14. Later on, the assessing officer sought to reopen the assessment beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. The SSE claimed that this could not be done because there was no failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure. The Delhi High Court negatived the claim of the SSE and held that the reopening is valid since no particulars relating to 14A were given either in the return or in the course of assessment. Friends, notice very carefully that in this case, the return was filed in November 2000 and the amendment was made in February 2001, 3 months later. How will I in November 2000 know that they are going to insert a section in February 2001? So I could not have given anything in the return. Yet, the Delhi High Court held so. Why? Because the full and true disclosure is not restricted only to the return. It is in relation to the return of income and also all information that has been given in the course of assessment as well. Right? That has been given in the course of assessment as well. Therefore, one can see that the question of full and true disclosure is not only dependent on the return, but also information produced in assessment. I mean, in other words, what the Delhi High Court is saying is, even if the assessing officer does not ask, and therefore you have not furnished, still one cannot say that you have made a full and true disclosure. This is rather very far-fetched, but that's how the court has interpreted. Now, when I talk of full and true disclosure, it is imperative that I deal with another section, another decision of Supreme Court in a case called NDT, right? The New Delhi Television Limited, where the issues before the Supreme Court were multifold. NDT, the New Delhi Television Limited. Now, here was a case where the Supreme Court reversed the finding of the Delhi High Court. The Supreme Court reversed the finding of the Delhi High Court. Of course, it did say that a reopening may be possible if later on it is found that the second proviso to section 1 the facts and circumstances. I am now dealing with the decision of the Supreme Court in NDTV Limited. Now, in the case of NDTV Limited, there were some transactions. It was all circuitous transactions. I don't want to get into each and every transaction. And where the subsequent year, some additions were proposed in the draft assessment order and were upheld by the, were reversed by the DRP, saying that these transactions do not pertain to the impugned year, but pertain to an earlier year. The SEC, without getting into too much of detail, the SEC NDTV sought to raise capital from various places, and the assessing officer sought to invoke the provisions of Section 68. The DRP held that the transaction relates to an earlier year. Now, the assessing officer wanted to reopen the assessment of the earlier year. The SEC argued that it is not possible to reopen the assessment of an earlier year merely based on a finding of the DRP in a subsequent year. The Supreme Court held that findings in a different assessment year can definitely be a basis for reopening. And then later on went on to hold in favor of SEC, though this part was against SEC. They went on to hold in favor of SEC that the reopening was bad in law in the facts and circumstances because there was a full and true disclosure on the part of the SEC. Now, the revenue argued saying the disclosure was made, but the SEC had not given any assistance in the course of original assessment to draw certain inferences from the facts. I have brought in some capital in my name from a foreign source in the name of my company. I said I have brought in capital. But then what the department says is you should not have merely said you brought in capital. You should have pointed out that there is a possibility that it can be bogus. The Supreme Court negatived this and said that SEC is not required to give any assistance to AO by way of disclosure of other facts. The AO can draw his own inferences. The primary facts alone need to be made available by the SEC, in which case the SEC can be said to have made a full and true disclosure. SEC can be said to have made a full and true disclosure. Right? So this is the decision of the Supreme Court in India. So one can observe and notice, that what the Supreme Court is drawing as a rule is that all primary facts should be placed by SEC. Inferences need not be brought to the notice of the assessing officer by the SEC. Inferences the assessing officer may draw, but then so long as the SEC has made a full and true disclosure of primary facts, the assessing officer cannot normally reopen beyond 4 years from the end of the relevant assessment. Now, having said this, there are a number of other things that one may have to read and understand, particularly in the context of the aspect relating to change of opinion. And with regard to making a full and true disclosure by the SEC. They said full and true disclosure is of primary facts, not of inferences thereof. Change of opinion can never be the basis for a reopening. Now, at this stage, one normal question that comes whenever we talk about change of opinion is, what about an audit objection? Can this be said to be a sound basis for reopening? In fact, there are two decisions of Supreme Court. Friends, as I mentioned earlier, all the decisions are already available with you in the material circulated. You don't have to bother. Can I pause for a minute? I'll just come back in a minute, please.
I'm sorry,
I'm back. See, whether audit objection can be the basis for reopening, there are two decisions of Supreme Court. One is a case called PVS BDs, and the other is a case called Lucas PVS. Now, in Lucas PVS, the Supreme Court held that audit objection cannot be a basis for reopening. Audit objection cannot be a basis for reopening. Whereas in PVS BDs, on the basis of an audit objection, the Supreme Court upheld the reopening. So if one were to make these two statements, one may imagine that at first blush, there is a conflict between these two decisions. Actually, friends, there is no conflict at all. Now, what the Supreme Court was talking about was not at all about audit objection. Again, friends, one should not confuse oneself with audit objection being a basis, etc. One has to see whether it amounts to a change of opinion. I'll briefly explain what happened in Lucas versus what happened in PVS BDs. In PVS BDs, the issue was purely factual. The assessing officer had missed to notice a factual point. And therefore, the Supreme Court held that reopening is valid. But in Lucas PVS, there was a legal view that was taken by the assessing officer, which on the audit party took a different view of the matter. The assessing officer took one view of a legal matter, that is an interpretation issue, and the assessing officer took a different view, or subsequent assessing officer took a different view of the matter on the basis of an audit objection. Supreme Court said, no, this is amounting to a change of opinion and the reopening is bad in law. So again, we are only boiling down to a change of opinion. In fact, there is also a classic decision of the Madras High Court in a case called Buyer Shoes. In fact, if one were to see the decision in Buyer Shoes, one can see that the reopening was sought to be done based on a changed position in law, an amendment in the law. The Madras High Court said, no, that cannot be done. Based on amendment in law, you cannot reopen because you are changing your opinion. You took an opinion in a particular manner merely because a clarificatory amendment has come. You cannot take a different view of the matter, and that will amount to a change of opinion. In fact, if I were the assessing officer of Buyer Shoes, I would have issued a rectification notice and probably rectified the order under 154 itself. That would have been enough. Unfortunately, the assessing officer tried to use 148, which was ultimately struck down. So we were talking about going back, reasons to believe income chargeable to tax escaped assessment, and then wherever required, proper sanction being obtained before issuing a reopening notice. So when we talk of sanction before issuance of reopening notice, one should look at the background. The law requires, at different points in time, the law has required different authorities to exercise their power to issue a sanction. Now, two very important points in relation to sanction. Very, very important points in relation to sanction. Now, a sanction is required where the reopening is beyond 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, and the sanction is to be given by certain specified authority. Now, in what happened in one case was that there are a number of decisions on this. What happened in these cases was that the assessing officer had to obtain the consent or the sanction of the joint commissioner, but had obtained the sanction of the commissioner of income. but had obtained the sanction of the Commissioner of India. A question arose. After all, it has been sanctioned by a higher authority. Is that sufficient? The courts held no. The courts held otherwise. They said no, where a reopening has to be done on the basis of a sanction of a joint commissioner, it has to be done only by the joint commissioner. In fact, in the lighter vein, if I were to say, after all, the President of India is higher than income tax officer. So can President of India pass an assessment order? The answer has to be necessarily no. The same way, merely because somebody is a higher officer, his sanction is not sufficient. If the sanction has to come only from a lower rank officer. This is one aspect. Another very important aspect. We were talking about reason to believe, and we said these should be recorded in writing, and we were saying there should be a live link between the reason and the escapement of income. I mean, so far as sanction is concerned, what? Now, normally, what happens is there is a pro forma. I'm telling you in practice. See, in fact, if you take any book on income tax, it says income tax law and practice. Right? Income tax law and practice. So, one is income tax law, two is income tax practice. Probably they are looking at it as slightly different from each other, because when you practically apply the law, certain things have to be really looked into. See, what happens when I want to do a reopening as an assessing officer is, there is a pro forma. I am supposed to send this pro forma to my commissioner and seek the proper sanction. Seek the sanction. Now, mostly what happens is, commissioner besides that says, sanction granted, or yes, satisfied, or just satisfied, or yes, I am satisfied. Now, there are a number of decisions of the courts, including decisions of the Supreme Court, which say that merely stating yes, I am satisfied, or I am satisfied, is not enough to justify a reopening. Right? So, the sanction should be after proper application of mind. If the sanction does not demonstrate proper application of mind, the reopening is still invalid. In fact, what we do in practice is whenever we file the letter or the return in response to a notice under 148, we follow it with a letter saying, please give us the reasons recorded in writing, and also the correspondences between the assessing officer and the joint commissioner of income tax, and the assessing officer and the commissioner. And we also sometimes apply for the same under the Right to Information Act to ensure that it is made available to us for us to be able to properly defend ourselves. Now, we try to see if a proper sanction has been obtained. These are some of the aspects that we pay our attention to at the time of ensuring that we comply with the notices in a proper fashion. Now, we were talking about a change of opinion. Incidentally, there are a couple of very interesting decisions. The decision of the Madras High Court in a case called Danmack, and there are subsequent decisions of the Madras High Court as well. And also the decision of the Delhi High Court in a case called Orient Craft. Now, in both of these cases, the High Courts have held that no reopening is possible unless there is fresh tangible material. I repeat, no reopening is possible unless there is fresh tangible material, even in a case where there was no original assessment framed, but only an intimation was passed under 143.1. Right? But only an intimation was passed under 143.1. Now, we were discussing about several other aspects. Reason to believe must be there. Income must have, chargeable to tax must have escaped assessment. Thereafter, proper sanction. And then a notice must be issued under 148. Next, we were discussing. What is the right course of action there? The Supreme Court said, once the SSC receives the notice under 148, the right course of action, the right course of action on the part of the SSC is, the right course of action on the part of the SSC is to file a return in response to the notice and thereafter to seek reasons for the order. So, you will see that the first duty is on the assessing officer to issue a proper notice and serve it on the SSC. Having served it on the SSC, please note that the next obligation is on the SSC, where the SSC is required, the SSC is required to pass or to file a return in response to the notice. Once he completes this obligation of his, the SSC automatically gets a right. What is that right? The right to seek reasons for reopening. And as I said, we have been also asking for the sanction and communication between the assessing officer and the joint commissioner or additional commissioner, and also with the commissioner of income tax and vice versa. Right? And vice versa. So you have a right, as per the decision of Supreme Court, to ask for reasons for reopening. Now, what happens if you ask for the reasons? What happens if you ask for the reasons, but the reasons are not furnished by the assessing officer even up to the date of completion of assessment? There are a number of decisions, starting from the decision of the Bombay High Court in Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, the Bombay High Court in Formentor Resorts, the Karnataka High Court in V. Ramayya, the Bombay High Court in IDBA, all of its citations are there in the paper already, where each and every one of the high courts have held that reasons not being given despite request will invalidate the assessment or reassessment. Therefore, if the reasons are not recorded, also the reassessment is bad in law. If the reasons are recorded but not given to the SSC, still the assessment is bad. That takes me to the next question. If you see the sequence, what did the Supreme Court say in GK and Drive Shafts? In GK and Drive Shafts, the Supreme Court said that the assessing officer must issue notice, the SC must file return, then the SC can ask for reasons. After reasons are asked for, the SSC can file objections once the assessing officer gives the reason. So you can now file objections. In that you can state why the reopening is bad in law. And then what is the next stage? What is the next stage? The next stage is that the assessing officer must dispose of the objections by a speaking order. The assessing officer must dispose of the objections by a speaking order. Is it enough to dispose of the objections in the assessment order? No, it is not enough to dispose of the objections in the assessment order. It must be disposed of by a separate speaking order. That is the mandate of law, and that is what the Supreme Court held in GK and Drive Shafts. And that is what the Supreme Court held in GK and Drive Shafts. Now, having said that that is what the Supreme Court held in GK and Drive Shafts, the next question will be, what is the effect of not disposing of the objections by a speaking order? There are a number of decisions of various high courts, the Gujarat High Court in General Motors, the Madras High Court in various cases, and various other high courts, including the Bombay High Court, Delhi High Court, all of them, where they held that non-passing of a speaking order is fatal and the assessment is consequently, or the reassessment is consequently, invalid. I repeat, not disposing of the objections by a separate speaking order is fatal and will invalidate the reassessment proceeding is what various high courts have said. But then there is a very interesting decision of the Madras High Court in a case called Home Finders Housing Limited. There are also decisions of the Allahabad High Court on the same subject, where the high courts of Madras and Allahabad have held that failure to dispose of the objections by a speaking order will not invalidate the assessment, in that the assessment will not be held to be void, but the matter has to be set aside to file of assessing officer for him to dispose of the objections by a speaking order and thereafter to proceed to frame an assessment in accordance with law. Now, this is a very important decision. In fact, I am tempted to agree with the second of the views, the decision of the Madras High Court in Home Finders Housing Limited. Not because that is a high court, which is my jurisdiction, High Court, but because, see, basically, we have to understand about jurisdiction vesting with an officer. The minute I issue a notice under 148, I am getting jurisdiction. And I have given you the reasons as contemplated by the Supreme Court. So natural justice is satisfied at that stage. But unfortunately, a speaking order has not been passed. That by itself will not invalidate the assessment, but the assessment has to be set aside. At the same time, you cannot say the assessment is valid. Whereas in the earlier case, if reasons are not been given, then the assessment will be quashed straight away. Here it will not be quashed, but it will be set aside to the file of the assessing officer to be redone after disposing of the objections by a speaking order. I am still dealing with the basics relating to Rio. Now we discussed about the fact that there is a reopening which can happen within 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, or beyond 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, or up to 6 years from end of relevant. Now, beyond 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, there is a mandate that there must be a failure on the part of the SE to make a full and true disclosure, provided the original assessment was framed under 143. Right? At the same time, beyond 4 years from end of relevant assessment year, reopening is possible only if the income escaping assessment is rupees 1 lakh or more. Reopening is possible only if the income escaping assessment is rupees 1 lakh or more. Now, there are a number of high courts which have said that the reasons itself must indicate or must state, including decision of the Madras High Court in global signaling, etc., where the high courts have held that the reasons itself must indicate what is the quantum of income that is likely to have escaped assessment. And only if that figure crosses 1 lakh, the reopening is justified. Now, what happens if the quantum of income escaping is not stated in the reasons? That invalidates the reasons and consequently the reopening. Next. Failure to make full and true disclosure. I come back. I said, unless there is a failure on the part of the SE to make a full and true disclosure in certain circumstances, a reopening is not justified. Right? In such a case, there is one other aspect that has to be borne in mind. Should the reason state what is the failure on the part of the SE to make a full and true disclosure? In fact, the Madras High Court, the Delhi High Court, all of them, Madras High Court in a case called Swingstetter, the Bombay High Court, the Delhi High Court in Orient Craft, all of them have held, consistently held, that you must state what is the failure on the part of the SSE to make a full and true disclosure. In fact, this issue came up before the Supreme Court in NDTV also. where the Supreme Court also said, so long as there is a full and true disclosure, beyond 4 years, no reopening is possible. Beyond 4 years, no reopening is possible. Right? So, it is imperative to notice that there must be a failure on the part of the EC to make a full and true disclosure. If the reopening is to be made beyond 4 years, of course, if it is a foreign asset, then it's a different issue altogether. I will not deal with that. That is found in the second proviso to section 148. And there, it does not deal with failure on the part of the SC to make a full and true disclosure. So we understand and appreciate that there must be a failure. Now, what the courts have held, that it is not enough if there is a failure. You must get what is the failure. In fact, I have seen so many reasons where the reopening is done beyond 4 years, where the assessing officer says it is noticed from the record that. But the minute you write it is noticed from the record, then there is no failure on my part to make a full and true disclosure. This is the obvious conclusion that one has to reach. If one were to argue that there is a failure on the part of the SC to make a full and true disclosure, the very edifice of it is that it should not be available from the record as such. It should be a fresh material that has come, and then only you can say there is a failure on the part of the SC. So what is that failure must also be stated in the reasons itself. Failure to state that in the reasons will entail the assessment to be held or the reassessment to be held bad in law. Right? Now, we have been talking about various aspects. There is one other very important aspect. What happens is, in many cases, the officer receives some kind of information from various departments or various divisions of the income tax department itself that there is some, you know, possibility of escapement of income in certain cases by the SSC. Will that be enough for the SSC to reopen? Sorry, the assessing officer to reopen. For reopening, reason to believe should be that of the assessing officer. Please remember, reason to believe must be that of the assessing officer. If there is no reason to believe on the part of the assessing officer, the reopening is valid. So, it should not be, I'll put it in this way, this reason should, or this satisfaction should not be what I call a borrowed satisfaction. It should not be a borrowed satisfaction. If it is a borrowed satisfaction, the reopening is bad in law. So, you can, as an assessing officer, get information from a third party. But before you record reasons, you must be able to demonstrate through the recording of reasons that there has been application of mind on your part as an assessing officer before you recorded the reason. Merely stating, I got information from investigation cell that SC has done bogus transaction, I have reason to believe. That is not enough. You have to say why you are satisfied, not why the investigation department is satisfied for reopening the assessment. So it is imperative and important to remember that it is necessary for the assessing officer to apply his mind and thereafter to come to the conclusion that there is a failure on the part of the SC to make a full and true disclosure, etc. And also that there is an escapement of income. Mere borrowed satisfaction is insufficient for the purpose of making or recording a satisfaction. It is impossible to record a satisfaction on that basis. And consequently, that will invalidate the reassessment proceeding itself. Now, we are talking about various aspects relating to reassessment. Now, when should this belief exist? in my understanding, the belief must exist at all times. The belief must exist at all times. That is, not only exist when I am recording the satisfaction, exist when I am passing the order, exist when the assessee challenges this in appeal and the matter comes in appellate fora for hearing. At every point, the reason should exist. For example, let us say, just for the argument's sake, let us say a reopening is done in your case based on the decision of the Kochi bench tribunal. Then let us assume that this Kochi bench tribunal has been reversed by the Kerala High Court. Of course, Kerala High Court hardly has decisions in favor of SSC. Most of them, very many decisions go against SSC. But be that as it may, let's take a situation where it has come in favor of SSC. Okay. So, what happens? Can the assessing officer now say, when they recorded the reason, there was a tribunal order, therefore I had reason to believe? Subsequently, Kerala High Court may have reversed it, but I still have reason to believe. No. The reason to believe at that point fails. And for this, the classic decision is again the decision of the Madras High Court in Baier Shoes, B-A-E-R Shoes. Now, we have spoken about reason failing to exist on various periods in time. Now, it is always possible that as an assessing officer, the assessing officer records a particular reason. He records a particular reason, but in the course of the assessment, finds that that reason is not valid any longer. He finds that that reason is not valid any longer. Right? What happens? What happens? Can he travel beyond the reasons? Is one part. And two, the reason having failed, can he still proceed with the reassessment? Now, insofar as traveling beyond reasons is concerned, you have explanation 3 to section 147. Explanation 3 to section 147, where the explanation specifically provides that the assessing officer can travel beyond the reasons recorded for the purpose of concluding the reassessment. That is, he can need not restrict himself only to issues that have been recorded as reasons. He can travel beyond that also and make other additions also. This is what the amendment provides. But then what happens if the reason itself fails? Now there are very number of decisions of the various courts, including the Bombay High Court in Jet Airways, the Gujarat High Court in Mohammad Junaid Dadani, the Delhi High Court in Ranbaxy, the Madras High Court in Martech Peripherals. All of these provide that if the reason fails, the reopening fails. I repeat, they held that if the reason fails, the reopening fails. In my opinion, this should be the correct position in law. This should be the correct position in law, even notwithstanding the explanation to section 147. Explanation 3 to section 147. It should not be permissible on the part of the revenue to reopen or extend the assessment even after the reasons have completely failed. But unfortunately, there is a contrary decision. There is a contrary decision of the Karnataka High Court in a case called N. Govindaraju. Though I do not agree with this view, the contrary view is found in N. Govindaraju, the Karnataka High Court, where they held that if the reason fails, still the assessing officer can proceed on other issues. I don't agree with this view, but unfortunately, this is a view that has been canvassed by the Karnataka. And I don't think that is a correct view. There are a number of decisions against this view. Okay. Now, speaking about reopening in this context, we discussed about whether it is possible to travel beyond the reasons. As I said, explanation 3 to section 147 clearly permits this. There seems to be no difficulty there. But if the reason fails, the reopening has to necessarily fail. Right? Now, what about multiple proceedings? During the pendency of one notice under 148, can there be another notice under 148? There are two decisions again. One, the Supreme Court in HEH Nizam, and two, the Kerala High Court, which is your jurisdiction, High Court, most of you, your jurisdiction, High Court, in Niloufar Hamid, where the decision said that multiple proceedings cannot be taken at the same time. Multiple proceedings cannot be taken at the same time. Now, the next question. I have filed a return. The time to issue notice under 143.2 is still there. The time to issue notice under 143.2 is still there. Whether reopening notice can be issued. Madras High Court, Delhi High Court, all the High Courts say not possible because that is a deemed pendency. Proceedings are deemed to be pending and it is not possible to reopen the assessment. It is not possible to reopen the assessment in such cases. Interestingly, there is one decision of the Bombay High Court in a case called Metro Auto Corporation. That's a very interesting decision. Now, what happened in that case was the assessee went in appeal and the appeal was held in favor of assessee by the tribunal. Against this order of the tribunal, the department went to the High Court. Against this order of the tribunal, the department went to the High Court and also reopened the assessee. The Bombay High Court said, once you have gone to the High Court on a particular issue, on the very same issue for any other assessment year also, you cannot reopen. Reason being, then you are taking two conflicting stands before the appellate authorities. One year you are saying that your assessment itself is valid. In another, you are, by reopening the assessment, you are saying that the assessment for that year may not be valid, but for this year is valid. So that also cannot be done. Likewise, reopening on the basis of certain estimates, particularly the decision of the Supreme Court in Daria Constructions, where the Supreme Court held that no reopening is possible on the basis of a DVO's report. Why did they hold so? Why did they say that a reopening is not possible on the basis of a DVO's report? A DVO's report is an estimate. They said, on the basis of an estimate, no reopening is possible. And again, there are other, very many other high courts on the same issue on whether reopening is possible. Next, assessee has got a notice under 148. But the assessee finds that while on the one hand there is an escapement of income, the other hand there are other incomes which have wrongly been assessed, which don't deserve to be assessed, thereby making the reopening not necessary, because overall the effect of it is that there is no escapement. Can reopening be justified in such circumstances? Again, the answer is no. In fact, if one were to see the provisions of section 151, that itself will make it very clear that it is not possible. There are also decisions to this effect, and that will be the background in which one will have to look at these aspects. Now, I have got a notice under 148 from the assessing officer. I have responded to the notice by filing a return. Can the officer proceed to frame the assessment under 147? Read with 143.3, the answer in my opinion is no. It is necessary that a notice under 143.2 must be issued and served on the assessee within the time contemplated by 143.2. Without serving such notice under 143.2, it is not possible for a reopening to be concluded, because ultimately the assessment is framed under 147, read with 143.3. So unless it is a best judgment assessment which is being framed under 144, in all other circumstances, a 143.2 must be issued before a assessment can be concluded. Next, I want to claim certain deductions in reassessment. Can I claim certain deductions in reassessment? That's a very large question. Can I claim deductions in reassessment? The answer to this question is yes and no. When is my answer no? My answer is no when it relates to income that has already been assessed in the original proceedings. Income has already been assessed in the original proceedings. Then my answer is no. When is my answer yes? My answer is yes when it relates to the escaped income. I'll take a simple decision. You can look at the decision of the Supreme Court in a case called Sun Engineering Works, and also a decision of the Supreme Court in a case called Chettinad Corporation. Without going to all these decisions, let us take simple issues. Let's say my assessment is reopened because the assessing officer comes to know that I have been doing side by side a money lending business which I have never disclosed to the department. He wants to reopen my assessment. What should I do? Right? What should I do in such circumstances? Right? Can the assessing officer say, I will assess your gross interest receipts? After all, I have expenses against it. Can we say I will assess the gross interest receipts? The answer has to be no only. The answer has to be no only because it is not open to an assessing officer. He is not, after all, a GST officer. He is an income tax officer. So he has to take into account only the net income. Because this deduction is related to the escaped income. But if it is not related to the escaped income, but to an item of income which is already assessed to tax, whether it is possible, the answer is no. The answer is no, and that cannot be done. Now, these are various aspects that we have been dealing with in relation to a reopened assessment or a reassessment, as one would call it in general parlance. So we were talking about various aspects, starting from satisfaction, reasons, sanction, notice under 148 being served, return of income being filed, reasons being asked for, furnishing of reasons, passing of a speaking order, or rather filing of objections, passing of a speaking order. Then we were talking about disposal of the objections, we were talking about change of opinion, full and true disclosure, we have been talking about proper sanction being obtained, we have been talking about, you know, audit objection, we have been talking about, you know, information being obtained from other authorities under other law or under other departments from the income tax department itself, like the investigation wing, whether, you know, the assessing officer can travel beyond the reasons, what if the reasons fail completely. So one can go on and on and on, friends, on various aspects relating to reassessment. This is not just the end of it. What we have spoken is just broadly about reassessment. Now at this stage, let me request all my friends who are here with me participating in this webinar to post their queries so that it will be easier for us to address it as and when they are raised. What I will do is, for the time being, move on to revisions and then probably come back to reopening if and when time permits and based on queries that are raised. Now, revision. Revisionary powers are contained in section 263 and 264 of the Income Act. They are contained in sections 263 and 264 of the Income Act. In fact, 263 and 264 deal with two different kinds of revisions. 263 talks about a revision by a commissioner of income tax or a principal commissioner of income tax. A revision by a commissioner of income tax or a principal commissioner of income tax. Give me a minute's break, please. I'll just join. I'm sorry, and I'm back. So, gives the power to the commissioner or the principal commissioner to revise an order passed by an assessing officer, where such order is erroneous in so far as it is prejudicial to the interest of the revenue. So, I repeat, power to revise an order passed by an assessing officer, where such order is erroneous in so far as it is prejudicial to the interest of the revenue. So, first of all, it should be an order of an assessing officer for it to be subject to revision. At this stage, please note very carefully that the law has been very carefully drafted. It doesn't say it should be an assessment order. It says it should be an order of an assessing officer. It need not be an assessment order. An order levying penalty can also be subject to revision, for example. Any order passed by an assessing officer can be a subject matter of revision by the commissioner or principal commissioner. Provided such order is erroneous in so far as it is prejudicial to the interest of the revenue. At this stage, it is important to notice two decisions of the Supreme Court, the first of these being Malabar Industrial Corporation, which arose from Kerala, and the other, Max India, where the Supreme Court held in both these cases that for a 263 power to be invoked by a commissioner, there must be an error and a prejudice. I repeat, an error and prejudice. It is not enough if there is an error. If there is no prejudice, 263 is not possible. It is not enough if there is a prejudice, there must be an error also. I'll explain these terms as we proceed. So, an order of an assessing officer which is erroneous in so far as it is prejudicial to the interest of the revenue can be subject matter of 263 by the commissioner or principal commissioner. Now, what can he do? He can pass such orders as he deems fit, setting aside the order or enhancing the order of assessment that is already prepared. Enhancing or setting aside and directing a fresh assessment. Right? These are the powers of the commissioner. Of course, you are talking about error and prejudice. Now, error means a mistake. Prejudice means some harm should have been passed. So, if by, just take a simple example, if by mistake I as an assessing officer have not allowed you a relief which you are entitled to, can one say that this can be subject matter of 263? The answer is a categorical no. Why? Because there is an error but no prejudice. There is an error but no prejudice. On the other hand, there is a prejudice, let us say. Something that is unfavorable to the revenue has been done, but then there are two views possible in the matter. Then what happens? And there is no jurisdictional high court on the matter. Then what happens? Then one can take a view that though there is a prejudice, there is no error. Of course, if there is a high court which is jurisdictional on the matter, then one can say that there is an error and prejudice. Even though a non-jurisdictional high court may be in favor of assessment. Right? So, one has to examine whether there is an error in prejudice. A very important aspect. What if a particular aspect has not been discussed by the assessing officer in the assessment order? There is this wonderful decision of the Bombay High Court in a case called Gabriel India. a case called Gabriel India. What happened in Gabriel India? Questions were raised, answers were given, but they were not finding part in the assessment order. The commissioner came to the conclusion that there has been no investigation by the department. The Bombay High Court said, if one were to record every aspect before passing an order in the order of assessment itself, then officers will not pass orders but will write theses for getting doctorate degrees. And ultimately held that it need not be finding part in the assessment order. Now at this stage, it is very imperative and important, interesting to understand the difference between lack of investigation and improper investigation. Right? Now the Delhi High Court and very many high courts have taken a view that lack of investigation results in an error and prejudice, and 263 is permissible. Right? Lack of investigation, 263 is permissible. But what happens if it is not a case of lack of investigation but improper investigation? It is improper investigation, then what happens? Logically, each and every high court which has considered this matter has said that lack of investigation is a case for reopening, but improper investigation is not. In fact, I was talking about two views possible, etc. In that context, you may look to the decision of Supreme Court in Max India Limited, where the Supreme Court held in a particular manner, holding that, you know, it cannot be said to be a matter which can be subject to 260. In fact, there is also a classic decision of the Madras High Court in a case called Sriram Systems and Software. Right? Sriram Systems and Software. Okay. Now, in this case, what happened was there was search in the premises and certain compact discs were found, CDs were found. The assessing officer, without looking into the CDs, completed the assessment. The issue was whether this can be said to be a subject matter where one can say there is an error in prejudice. The Madras High Court held yes. But unfortunately, one aspect was never urged by the SSC. I don't know why. The SSC never urged that these CDs were not relevant for the purpose of concluding this. Maybe if that had been urged, the conclusion may have been different. The conclusion may have been different. Now, the next aspect is with regard to the power to revise what we understand as summary assessments or assessments that are framed under 143.1. Whether this can be subject matter of a revision, or whether a 143.1 can be subject matter of a revision under 243. This can be subject matter of revision under 260. Okay. Now, there are conflicting decisions. The Madras High Court and the Bombay High Court have held that it is possible for a 143.1 to be revised under 263. However, the Calcutta High Court has held against SSC. I personally will agree with the view expressed by the Madras High Court and the Bombay High Court, because particularly post the amendment made from 1989, 143.1 is also to be deemed as an order of assessment. Though no opinion is formed, it is an order of assessment. In fact, they have made it an appealable order also. I will probably deal with one or two other aspects and then proceed to 264. Now, what if penalty proceedings have to be revised? Whether they can be revised? The answer is yes. Because the law only says any order of an assessing officer, there is no need that it should be an assessment order. It should only be an order of an assessing officer. That itself is enough for a revision to be made. Right? And in this context, there have been a couple of issues. What if in the assessment, you all are aware that for penalty under 271(1)(c) to be levied, it is necessary that proceedings must be initiated in the order of assessment, where they will say penalty proceedings initiated separately. What if that is not stated? Whether non-stating of that can we make the order of assessment erroneous and prejudicial, and therefore can be subject to 260? My personal view is no. In fact, there are a number of high courts on this as well, where they hold that it is not possible. See, please understand, initiation or otherwise of penalty under 271(1)(c) is at the discretion of the assessing officer, where he has to come to the subjective conclusion that there is concealment or furnishing of inaccurate particulars of income for him to be recording that satisfaction in the order. If he does not do so, it does not give the liberty to the commissioner to do it, because then he is impinging on the discretion of the officer. But if the officer initiates and drops the penalty, that is an order which can be subject to 263 if there is an error and prejudice found in that order. In fact, there is also a very interesting decision of the Supreme Court in a case called Toyota Motor Corporation, where the issue before Supreme Court was, what happens in a scenario where the penalty is initiated but not dropped by an order, but by an order sheet noting. Supreme Court held even the order sheet noting is an order and can be subjected to 263. I'll leave one last aspect on 263. What is the time limit? Everyone is aware that the time limit under 263 is 2 years from the end of the financial year in which the order sought to be revised was passed. 2 years from the end of the financial year in which the order sought to be revised was passed. Now, when you talk of this, let us assume there is an order in which there are two errors. An assessing officer committed two errors in an order, error A and error B. And let us assume he passed this order. I will not take this pandemic year because it's going to be very tough if you take this pandemic year, because pandemic year time limits have all been extended. So let's assume that there are two errors found in the order passed in March 2000 or December 2014. Now, within 2 years from the end of the financial year, March 2015, March 2017, the commissioner can revise the order. Now, let's assume he revised the order only revising one of the errors. Now there is one more error left. Will the time frame in March 2017, he passed the 263. Will the time frame for revising the second error start from 2014, December, or from March 2017? The answer is from 2014, December. Because both the errors are found in that original order. And to this effect, there are decisions of the Supreme Court also in Alagendra and Finance. Incidentally, I must mention here before I proceed further that the Supreme Court in Hindwire, in the context of section 154, rectification of mistake apparent on record, has taken a view that for rectification, the time will start from the date of the rectification order. Whereas for revision, the Supreme Court has taken a view that it will start from the original order, because the commissioner cannot revise his order. If the mistake or the error has happened in his 263 order, he cannot revise it. He can only revise an order of an assessing officer. That is the reason why the Supreme Court has taken this view. I'll quickly move on to 264. Now, 264 again is a not very largely used section, but can be used with great benefit to many SSEs in many circles. When can 264 be passed? 264 can be passed by the commissioner or the principal commissioner of income tax, where it is not an order referred to in 263, where it is not an order referred to in 263, and where there is a scope for a revision. Now, when can you say that it can be revised? Can you say that it can be revised only in a case where a particular plea has been taken before the assessing officer? No. The commissioner is entitled to revise the order of the assessing of the lower subordinate authority, the subordinate authority, even if the assessing or assessee raises a fresh claim for the first time before him in 264. Also note that 264 refers to an order passed by a subordinate authority. It does not refer to an order passed by an AO. For example, an order passed by a tax recovery officer can be subjected to 264, cannot be subjected to 263. Reason being, 263 talks of an assessing officer, 264 talks of a subordinate authority. Right? Now, when can this be done? It says the law provides that it can be done either by the assessee on the request of the assessee or suo moto. When can it be done? Either suo moto by the commissioner or principal commissioner or an application from the assessee. Application of the assessee to be made within 1 year from the date on which the order is communicated to him. Commissioner, of course, has the power to condone any delay, and the commissioner is to pass his order within 1 year from the end of the financial year when the application is made. And if no application is made, it can be done suo moto within the same time. It can be done suo moto within the same time. Of course, one has to waive his right of appeal in such circumstances, and the Supreme Court in Hindustan Aeronautics has explained the scope of 264 vis-a-vis 246A, that is an appeal, and said that once you have preferred an appeal, against that order, you cannot claim the benefit of 264 at all. Reason being, that 264 specifically says that it should be an order against which no appeal has been filed. Incidentally, the Madras High Court, in a case called D. Lakshmi Narayana Pati, has taken a view that if you have filed 264, that is no bar on going under 246A in an appeal. But going under 246A is a bar against filing an appeal. This is how the courts have viewed it. Incidentally, there are decisions which also say that if the commissioner has passed an ex parte or has passed an order dismissing the appeal in limine. For example, if you see 249.4, it requires payment of taxes before filing an appeal. If taxes are not paid, and therefore the commissioner disposes of the appeal in limine, saying the appeal is not maintainable, then according to the High Courts, the 264 is maintainable. Please note that there is a fee of ₹500 for filing the 264. Also remember that in 264, there can be no order passed by the commissioner or principal commissioner which is prejudicial to the assessee. Please also note that the commissioner or the principal commissioner declining to interfere with an order passed by a subordinate authority is not deemed to be prejudicial to the assessor. And therefore, he can decline to interfere or pass an order which is beneficial. He cannot pass an order against the assessor. This is what 264 is all about. I have a few questions. Maybe I will take these questions, but with the request that others can share their questions at the earliest so that we can address the questions also. Of course, the questions that have come are not directly on reopening, but to the extent possible, let me try to answer. Where an income has been declared in a return pursuant to a survey on estimate basis without quantifying any unaccounted investment found, and the AO accepted the return filed, can the commissioner invoke 263 on the ground of an audit objection for not invoking 115 BBE of the Act on such disclosed income? Now, this is a very tricky question, I must say. It is very carefully worded. not giving scope for one to understand. I think it has been done on purpose. Very carefully worded. I must really, really congratulate the querist, because whether this 115 BBE is post the amendment making the tax rate 60% or before the tax rate being at 30%. So one is what happens if it is 60%. Of course, if it is 60% to 63% can be done. There is no doubt at all in my mind. Because that if it should be assessed at 60%, then the tax rate has to be 60%. But then the question is again even trickier. Where an income has been declared in a return pursuant to survey on estimate basis without quantifying unaccounted investment. Please note that the provisions of 115 BBE are applicable only when the provisions of 68 to 69D get triggered. 68 deals with an unexplained credit in the books of account. 69 to 69B deal with unaccounted investments or investments partly recorded. 69C deals with unexplained expenditure, and 69D deals with hundi. Now, if I have declared an income which is on an estimate basis, which is not related to a credit, an investment or an expenditure, then the provisions of section 68 to 69D are not triggered at all. Therefore, 115 BBE is not at all invocable. When can 115 BBE be invoked? When 68 to 69D are applicable. Now, in the example or in the queries, the question, it clearly says estimated income not related to assets at all. Therefore, 68 to 69B and 69C and D are not applicable to the facts and circumstances of the case. If that is so, then 115 BBE is not invocable, and if 115 BBE is not invocable, it has to necessarily follow that 263 is also not permissible in the facts and circumstances. I was again, say that the querist has put the question so nicely that I am very, very impressed with the way the question has been drafted. But this is my view. 263 is not invocable in this circumstance. The next is GST paid after due date for filing the return, whether required to be disallowed under 43B. Now, if I can repeat the question so that I make sure that I have understood the query clearly. Now, what the SSE is probably trying to suggest, or what the querist is suggesting, is that GST has not been credited to the income and P&L account and not debited to P&L account. It is recorded at net of GST, and therefore 43B should not apply. Is that the querist? What the querist wants to know can be clarified through a question, can be clarified through a chat, but in the meantime, for me to proceed, in my understanding, whether these are routed through the P&L account or not routed through the P&L account, 43B is applicable. 43B is applicable whether it has been routed through the P&L or not routed through the P&L. In fact, there are decisions in the context of 43B where such a view has been taken, and I would personally subscribe to the view, because if you see section 145A of the Income Tax Act, it requires you to show all the turnover inclusive of all tax collected. You are supposed to follow what is called the inclusive method. Merely because you have chosen to follow a different method, I would think that the rigors of 43B cannot be done away with, and 43B will be applicable in the facts and circumstances. Now, friends, I think I have troubled you enough with reopening and revision, and whatever queries have been posted with me, I have probably done with it. Unless you have any other queries which can be raised, with the permission of course the organizers, I can address. Otherwise, I must thank the organizers, particularly the chairman, for this opportunity. Because I must say that every single exercise of speaking is an exercise of learning. There are new points that we learn every time. And I have learned this time as well. Right? I have learned this time as well. Therefore, I will thank the organizers of the branch and particularly the chairman for having chased me down and got hold of me and given me this opportunity to share all my thoughts with all of you. And also a very big thank you to all of you for a very patient hearing. Thank you very much. I hand over the proceedings back to the organizers.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for your excellent and seamless presentation over the entire 2 hours without wasting a single minute, and for enlightening the members and the participants of Kannur branch through the various provisions on revision and reassessment, which is substantiated with the legal means decisions of various courts. Sir, absolutely great, and I'm sure that the participants are enlightened with your presentation over the 2 hours. And meanwhile, sir, two more questions are seen in the chat box, which came privately. One question is from the Kumarabhat sir, that whether reasons related for reopening can be asked after filing of return in response to notice under section 148, but before passing an order.
Sir, the decision of Supreme Court in GK and drive shafts is relevant. The Supreme Court in GK and drive shafts has said after giving the filing the return, you can ask for reason. So, in fact, I will put it this way. Only after filing the return, you can ask for the reasons. So, the query is asked whether we can ask reasons after filing. I'll put it differently. After filing only, you can ask. You can definitely ask for the reasons. You can definitely ask for the reasons after filing the return appeal. There's no doubt at all.
Right, sir. Okay. So, he has added one more question whether assessing officer can take any other issue after reopening is valid.
Once he concludes that the reopening is valid, whether he can travel to other issues, the provisions of law, explanation 3 to section 147 provides for it. In fact, prior to explanation 3, there were 3 decisions largely. One was your own Kerala High Court in Travancore Simmons, and 2 other decisions of the Punjab and Haryana High Court in Vipin Khanna and also in MP Iron, where they held that you cannot travel beyond the reasons. But thereafter, the introduction of explanation 3 to 147 permits the assessing officer to travel beyond the reasons. But remember, provided the reason is valid. If the reason goes, the reopening goes. That is the decision of the Bombay High Court in Jet Airways.
Right. Sir, in the same year, he has added one more. The part C is whether objection to assessment can be filed on the 11th hour on the last day of getting order time barred. Whether objection to assessment can be filed on the 11th hour on the last date of getting order time barred.
In fact, there are a couple of decisions on what are the time limits. But all the decisions are only said the time limits are recommendatory in nature. See, to file the objections at the 11th hour is not barred by any law. You can file your objections at the 11th hour. But then you cannot expect the assessing officer to wait till the 11th hour to proceed to assess. So he will proceed with his assessment. You file at the 11th hour. He will dispose of those objections probably through the assessment order, but not through a separate speaking order. Because he cannot be expected to pass the objection order, speak through a speaking order, and then issue 143-2 at the 11th hour. For him, there are time limits. He has to start the assessment. So, doing it at the 11th hour may disentitle you from getting a separate speaking order, which means that you are right to file a writ petition at that time. See, once you get a speaking order, you can always choose to file a writ petition saying that the reopening is bad. But if you do this at the 11th hour, you are doing it at the risk of losing your right to file a writ petition.
Okay, sir. Okay. Right. Now, any further queries or questions? I feel with the permission of the faculty, I am informing that even if you have any questions other than reassessment, reopening, you can ask that question also.
No, good evening. JP?
Tell me.
Sir, I have a small one question regarding this. You are talking about this delay in payment of GST, whether it is allowable or disallowable. And I think what I understood from your discussion is if it is based on the accounting system, if it is putting into the balance sheet item, so normally it is not, it is allowable expense. If it is coming under profit and loss account and there is a delay in payment of GST, it is not allowable. Am I correct, sir?
I'm sorry, I said that either way the disallowance will operate.
Oh, either way the disallowance will operate. Okay. So one more thing regarding this, when calculating the definition turnover, suppose we have a income of 95 lakhs and GST is coming as 10 lakhs. And GST is coming, we are putting under balance sheet whether it is qualify as for tax audit under section 44AB, sir.
Sorry, sir, please come again.
Sorry, suppose we have a turnover of 95 lakhs showing in profit and loss account and a GST collection of 10 lakhs showing under balance sheet. So we have to do this tax audit under 44AB for this.
Your question is whether GST has to be included for the purpose of
yes.
40 limits.
Yes, sir.
For the purpose of 44AB limits.
44AB limits, sir.
There are a number of decisions which say yes, it should be. And I would think, in fact, the classic decision will be that of the Supreme Court in a case called Chaurangi Sales Bureau. Though not rendered directly in the context of 44AB.
Okay.
But where they have said that sales tax will form part of turnover.
Okay.
But at the same time, there are also decisions which say that if RC has ignored the sales tax and was inadvertently not done a tax audit, that will be reasonable cause for not levying penalty.
Okay, sir.
Incidentally, I have, for the benefit of all participants, I have shared my email ID. First one I shared wrongly. Now I have shared it correctly, saying ignore earlier one. Anybody who has any queries can please send me the queries over email and I will be glad to reply on a one-to-one basis also.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right.
Thanks, sir.
Yuman, sir, anything is to add? Okay. Any further query? We are going to conclude within 2 minutes. Okay. Sir, I think you have traveled through all the sections on revision and reassessment, and it was very, very excellent session. Once again, thanking on behalf of the Kannur branch and accepting my invitation, even a small invitation, and means invitation to you without any hesitation. Immediately you have made a return mail to me saying that yes, you please do it, sir. Absolutely thanking on behalf of Kannur branch, and I have never expected that I will get a reply from a great person like you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And
thank you so much.
Now I request the past chairman Rajiv sir to propose word of thanks. Rajiv sir, over to you.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Chairman of Kannur branch, C.A. Jay Prakash, the learned speaker of the day, C.A. Banushekar, sir, and my dear senior members and professional colleagues, good evening to all. I really deem it as a great honor for me to propose a word of thanks on this wonderful afternoon, where we had the great fortune of attending to one of the most learned and most wanted and authority on direct tax available in India. Before we had the privilege of listening to him during SIRC conferences, and before the corona regime, we could never think of listening to him in a small town like Kannur. Actually, we had to thank corona for getting such a great person to share his knowledge with us. Sir, it was
sorry to interrupt.
Please, sir.
Forget corona. Once corona is over, I will personally come to Kannur branch, meet every one of you in person for a seminar and a nice evening together.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Let us not be grateful to corona alone. Let us be grateful to corona for the limited purpose of permitting us to have a beginning.
Yeah, exactly.
That this is not the last session I'm going to do with you. The next session I'm going to do with you will be personally in your branch itself.
Oh, great, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Sir, actually, it was a relentless flow of knowledge for the last 2 hours. I'm sure that all the persons on the platform, this virtual platform has really benefited to a great extent. On behalf of all of us present here, let me express our sincere gratitude to you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I take this opportunity to thank our chairman, who is doing wonders during this corona. This is actually the 20th virtual CPE meeting he has organized at this bad times. On behalf of everyone, I thank our chairman, wonderful and very energetic chairman, for his excellent efforts in this regard.
Thank you.
Also thank all the senior members, including you, Mohan sir, he's there for the last 2 hours, and all the senior members and my professional colleagues for being part of this seminar. And I thank one and all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.